Welcome to the Equipping You in Grace podcast. We are so excited that you are joining us for the show today. This podcast aims to explore a biblical life view in a conversational tone. Let's join our host and founder of Servants of Grace, Dave Jenkins, for today's episode. Thanks so much for listening.
Welcome back to the Equipping You in Grace podcast. My name is Dave, and I'm the host for this podcast. And with me today is Dr. Kidd. Dr. Kidd, welcome back to the Equipping You in Grace podcast.
Thanks, Dave.
It's always good to have you on the show. Can you just tell us what's new in your life, marriage, and ministry, and your work at MBTS and Baylor, and what are you working on writing project-wise?
Well, classes have just started back at Baylor, and that's still my primary teaching gig, and I'll be going to Midwestern occasionally in the coming year to teach a class or two and to meet with graduate students, doctoral students, and so forth. And at Baylor, I'm continuing to work with PhD students and teaching undergraduates. I teach a whole range of students here, so that keeps things interesting. I've got three different book projects, as you know, that are coming out this year. I know we're going to talk about the book Who is an Evangelical, but then later on I've got a book on American religious history that's coming out with Zondervan, and I'm currently writing a book that I'm calling a sort of moral biography of Thomas Jefferson. And the reason for that is probably because Americans generally, but Christians too, are so interested in the founding fathers, and Jefferson has been a really controversial figure among Christians about what do we make of his religion, but also his moral life, because of the accusations about his relationship with Sally Hemings and they're supposedly their children together. And so there's just a lot of complicated issues with Jefferson. You know, he did his own edition of the Bible or the Gospels and cut out a lot of the miracles and so forth. So he's a fascinating character, both in terms of his own beliefs and but also his kind of moral universe. So that's what I'm trying to untangle with him.
When will that one come out?
Lord willing, it'll be out in 2021.
I'm looking forward to that. That'll be, I'm sure, no doubt, very helpful. So who's publishing that one? Do you know?
That's with Yale University Press again.
Oh, wonderful. You do a lot with them. Why don't you, for people that aren't familiar with them, you want to tell our listeners a little bit about Yale Press?
Yeah. So my connection with them has everything to do with my doctoral advisor, who was George Marsden at Notre Dame. And Marsden had published a couple of books with Yale, most significantly the Jonathan Edwards biography that he did with them, which was enormously successful in terms of critical acclaim, but also just book sales. And so he had such a great relationship with them that he helped open the door for me to be able to publish with them. And they're an interesting press, I think, among academic presses, because they probably do about a wide range of authors as any major academic press in America. So they of course, like so many university presses, they do a lot of secular, liberal, academic authors, and then they're happy to work with people like me, an evangelical Christian, obviously also an academic, and they're very happy to sort of address different audiences. And so I've done a number of books with them. My revised dissertation was with them. I did a book on the Great Awakening with them, biography of George Whitfield, and so forth. And the book Who is an Evangelical is with them. And now this book on Jefferson, too. So I just have a wonderful relationship with them. I hope they don't think twice about it ever, because it's just been a great publishing relationship.
Oh, that's wonderful to hear. I'm always interested to hear a little bit more about, publishers and everything, since I get so many books. So that's really cool. Can you please tell us about your book, Who is an Evangelical? The History of a Movement in Crisis. Why did you write it? And since this is going to go up when it comes out, how do you hope it'll be received?
Yeah, so a lot of my work before has been on the history of evangelical Christianity and the Great Awakening, George Whitfield. I did a book on American Christians and Islam that has a lot to do with the history of how evangelicals have viewed Islam. So I certainly had a lot of background in preparation for doing this book. And I found that especially a lot of my blogging over the past few years has been about the question of the use of the term evangelical in popular and media discourse. And I know you know, and a lot of your listeners will know that it is very confusing to keep up with how the word evangelical is being used. And almost all the time when it's used in the media, it's being used to talk about evangelical political behavior. There's very little interest in the media in evangelicals as Christians, but there's a flood of interest in evangelical political behavior. And that story really started in 1976 with Jimmy Carter's candidacy for president and a kind of a realization that there's this evangelical voting bloc out there that makes a difference in American politics. And then in 2016, of course, the interest in evangelical politics just went sky high with the overwhelming white evangelical, self-identifying evangelical support for Donald Trump. But I thought, you know, so much of this discussion tends to just politicize evangelicals and depend on polling data about people who say that they're evangelicals. But how much of this is connected to the sort of historic and global evangelical movement? And my concern is that a lot of the discussion about evangelicals today, you know, it's really limited to, of course, whites, which is what the polling data is almost always interested in, is self-identifying white evangelicals. And white evangelicals who vote, of course, you know, a pretty strong percentage of evangelicals don't vote in any given election, but they're still evangelicals. Of course, just American evangelicals and Republican evangelicals and so forth. And then the more you dig into the polling data, you start realizing, you know, we often know almost nothing about these people who say that they're evangelicals, pollsters, because it depends on self-identification and not any kind of, you know, religious or theological metrics. So I felt like that there was an opening there to sort of speak into these kind of confused areas. And so I'm really writing for pastors, for journalists, for academics who might have at least a kind of secondary interest in evangelicals. And I'm really trying to put in a plug for understanding evangelicals first and foremost as a kind of historical theological movement rather than a subset of the Republican Party in America.
Yeah, I thought it was definitely a very helpful and interesting book that is very helpful. And I can't think of anybody I'd rather ask this next question to than you. So I'm really curious about how you're going to respond to it. So here's the question. Can you tell us how the term evangelical has been used throughout its history, and how has it changed over the years?
Even before the Great Awakening in the 1740s, people would use the term evangelical, and it really goes back to the Reformation in you know, English usage. Of course, evangelical, the evangel is based on a Greek term for good news, but in English usage, it really kind of rejuvenated by the Reformation. And when people would talk about evangelical, it was almost always an adjective, you know, evangelical preaching or an evangelical pastor or an evangelical book or something like that. That would call Isaiah the evangelical prophet. And that usually just meant something related to the gospel maybe something that's associated with the faith of the Reformation. As you get down into the era of the Great Awakening, it becomes appropriated to apply to the movement associated with the Great Awakening. And so you have evangelical preachers and, again, evangelical books, but they're now more often associated with the leaders of the Great Awakening, so Jonathan Edwards and George Whitefield and John Wesley and so forth. Evangelical, after the Great Awakening, tends to mean people, it tends to be a descriptor for people who are in the tradition of especially George Whitefield, who was the great evangelist of the Great Awakening. In the 1800s, it starts to sometimes be used as a noun and a self-identifier, and you start to get moral reform organizations and Bible societies and so forth who sometimes will use the term evangelical to describe a kind of interdenominational, gospel-focused, revival-focused movement. But it's still not necessarily that common for people to say, I am an evangelical. I mean, that I think is really become solidified with the founding of the National Association of Evangelicals in the 1940s. Anecdotally, I mean, you hear from the founders of the National Association of Evangelicals that they actually picked that term evangelical because it wasn't that commonly used as a noun. And so they thought, well, this will help us to set ourselves apart from other kinds of Christians in America. And so people like Harold Ockingay, who's one of the founders of the NAE, or Carl Henry, who's definitely one of the most important evangelical leaders of the mid-20th century, start to make this very common, where people will call themselves evangelicals. Subsequent to the founding of the National Association of Evangelicals, you also get the National Association of Black Evangelicals, who are interested in the same kind of gospel issues, but also in civil rights reform, which the NAE was a little more cautious about. And then in 1976, as I said before, the word evangelical just bursts onto the national media scene because Jimmy Carter accepted that term as a descriptor for himself. And so the media all of a sudden had to cover evangelicals and understand what that term meant. 1976 was declared the year of the evangelical. I think by time, it all of a sudden that year the word evangelical becomes far more nationally prominent than I think it ever had been before. But critically, in 1976, the word evangelical was also directly associated with politics. And so I think that's where the implicit political associations really start to become solidified.
That's a brilliant answer. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, definitely. What's your definition of evangelicalism? I know there's David Bevington's definition out there, but how would you define what evangelicalism is?
Yeah, and Dr. Bevington and I have had long discussions about this. He's actually here this semester at Baylor teaching for us, and so he's down the hall from me, I think, right now. We have a sort of friendly disagreement about some of the details on this. I think, Bevington's definition has four components to it, which is fine, and I think it's a good definition, but I think a couple of his aspects of evangelicalism are too broadly applicable to lots of kinds of Christians, especially, he says, crucicentrism or the centrality of the cross and activism are hallmarks of evangelicals. But I think that the problem with that is that there are other Christians who you could say the same thing about. Lots of Christian groups think that you should be active about your faith. I mean, whether you are or not might be another question. And, having gone in Notre Dame, I sure know that Catholics have the cross at the center of their faith in different ways from evangelicals, but every classroom in Notre Dame has a crucifix in it. So even just in a visual sense, I think that it's the cross is not just an evangelical feature. So I think David is right about the centrality of Biblicism. I think that evangelicals do attach a sort of unique authority and premium to the Bible. Now, that's something that they drew on from the Reformers, of course. I mean, it's not like it was new in the era of the Great Awakening to be dependent on the authority of the Bible. But especially after the fundamentalist modernist controversy of the late 19th and early 20th century, evangelicals came to sort of stand out as not receiving higher biblical criticism and increasingly to affirm the inerrancy of Scripture. And then conversionism, the experience of conversion, I definitely think is an evangelical distinctive that your faith is centered on your faith journey is centered on the experience of conversion and you're having your life changed by being born again. Of course, other Christians have talked about John 3 and Christ's exhortation to be born again, but evangelicals have made it much more central than I think most other Christians have. So I think that I would define evangelicals by conversion, biblicism, and then one other attribute that Bevington didn't include, which is the felt presence of God in your life. Some evangelicals talk about a personal relationship with Jesus. In the era of the Great Awakening, they were they sounded a little more charismatic or Pentecostal about it, and they would talk about walking in the Spirit. And that was what was new to Whitfield about his post-conversion life is the Holy Spirit's presence and leading in his life. But however you talk about it, if you're an evangelical, I think you believe in this relationship with God that's tangible, that's a sense of God's direct presence in your life that I think most other Christians don't really talk that way about their faith. And so I think, my definition is more of a three-part definition. It's experience of conversion, the primacy of the Bible, and the felt presence of God in your everyday life. Those seem to me to be three really foundational evangelical attributes.
Yeah, that's really good. I wish I could be a fly on the wall with you talking with Bevington. I wonder if there is anything recorded, like you guys debating this or anything like that?
I don't know if we've recorded it, but I talk about this in Who is an Evangelical, about comparing it to some extent with the Bevington quadrilateral. But I also talked about it in my Great Awakening book, that it's important to realize that and in the Whitfield biography, that for early evangelicals, the era of the Great Awakening, that felt presence of God is what seemed so new to them. And so they were used to the idea of the primacy of the Bible, for instance, going back to the Reformation. But what seemed so new to them was I can know God. I can have a personal relationship with God. And for them, it was theologically what was going on is that they were being led by the Holy Spirit. And so Whitfield talked about that constantly, especially in the first few years after his conversion.
That's really good. Based on our current cultural trajectory, what does the future of evangelicalism look like in America?
Well, I think that it's going to continue to be a politically controversial term, I think, for the foreseeable future. But I do think that the people who the media most often talks about as evangelicals, which is kind of, self-identified evangelical, who's white and Republican, and usually is a Fox News fan. I think that's a real segment of evangelicalism. But I think that if nothing else, just demographically, it's going to become a smaller segment of practicing evangelicals in America. And certainly when you put it in global context, that's a very small sliver of what evangelicalism is globally. Now, because those evangelicals have had access to political power in America, at least since 1980, and even going back to Billy Graham's relationship with Richard Nixon, Dwight Eisenhower, and so forth. I mean, that segment of Republican white evangelicals has had a lot more political power than most other evangelicals in the world. But I think it's also important to realize that that segment of kind of white Republican evangelicals by sheer force of demography and population patterns is going to become a smaller and smaller segment. Certainly in America, but absolutely on the global stage. There are definitely plenty of evangelicals who fit into that category, and they're real evangelicals, and they're active churchgoers. I think some of the people who identify as evangelicals in these kind of Republican news stories really do have kind of tenuous connections with any kind of evangelical churches, and it's mysterious in some ways about why some of these people actually identify as evangelicals. And then when pollsters ask more questions, which they usually don't, but when they do, it turns out that lots of these people don't go to church. Some of the people who identify as evangelicals are actually turn out to not be Protestants. There are Mormons who identify as evangelicals. There are Jehovah's Witnesses. There are Catholics. There are Eastern Orthodox people who identify as evangelicals. And then I think maybe, you know, the largest strange group among the self-identifying are the people who simply don't go to church, but they identify as evangelicals. And so, you know, I don't know quite what to do with that. Or to figure out, you know, what the mentality is of people who are the non-church-going evangelicals. But I think that also tells me that this group is more amorphous in a theological and religious sense and church sense than a simple kind of accounting of, 81% of evangelicals believe this and that. I think we've got to be a little cautious about making definitive conclusions about what evangelicals in America believe based on just that kind of polling data.
Yeah, that's really good. Really, a really helpful answer. What are a few of the most challenging issues that evangelicals face today?
Well, as you know, there are serious problems internally with biblical illiteracy, with, you know, people who say that their life is, totally surrounding the Lord and the Bible and so forth, and then they turn out to not actually know very much about the Bible or the faith that they profess. Those kind of things are of enduring concern, especially to pastors. But I also think that there are significant problems that we're facing in terms of, and I'm an evangelical, that's why I say we, in terms of not being in control anymore of the public perception of what an evangelical is, because of all these news stories now that have been going on for the better part of 50 years about evangelicals, quote unquote, and they're almost always focused on political behavior and the political behavior of evangelicals and Republican evangelicals. And so sometimes I get the sense that there are journalists who are really good at understanding evangelicals, for sure. And so I don't want to slam the whole media here. But sometimes you get the sense in the way the media talks about evangelicals that outsiders must just think that all we do is sit around and talk about politics and, you know, how we're going to get Trump reelected and so forth. And, you know, that's just not reflective, I think, of your average evangelical's church experience. I mean, you know, I'm taking my kids to youth tonight, and they're not going to talk about politics there. You know, I mean, that's not what we talk about on Sundays. And I mean, that you can find some evangelical churches that have, you know, really overtly political services or patriotic services, for sure. But I think the reason why evangelicals, practicing evangelicals or evangelicals, I like to think, doesn't have much to do directly with politics. It has to do with conversion and the Bible and the felt presence of God. I mean, you know, that to me is what globally, historically defines evangelicals. And so I don't really know what we can do about this other than to just talk about it. And that's one of the reasons why I wrote the book, is to say, you know, there's a disjunction now between the kind of what scholars call lived religion, the kind of everyday life of a believer. There's a disjunction between that and then what you see in the media discussion about evangelicals, which is always politicized. I just think that pastors and people who write about religion need to have this issue on their radar screen that, the everyday life of a believer, I don't think for most believers, is defined by politics.
Yeah, that's really helpful. I think you're onto something there. You know, we have people who they know this stuff in their head, but we know in the Bible to know is in the heart. And so, you know, we're so influenced by a Western view of knowledge, focusing on our brains and filling our heads. And not that there's anything wrong with having that, but to the Jews, it was knowing it in the heart and then having it affect our experience. And, you know, I don't think we talk about that kind of, I don't know, I'm not going to say in every church, but I do think that we do need to have a conversation about that. What is real knowledge and how do you know something? But I think that we just should just have a conversation about knowledge and how do we know what we know? Then we'll be able to have another conversation about, you know, the biblical idea of understanding and how those two concepts relate. And, you know, specifically like in the wisdom literature, you know, knowing leads to understanding. It leads to fearing God. And you know, I think that we need to have more. I guess what I'm saying is, to me, what I see is we need to have more foundational conversations, because the conversations by and large that we're having are not necessarily the wrong ones, but they're surface level ones. And we have to, the statistics are telling us that the problems are foundational, as you know well.
That's right.
What are the priorities you would like to see evangelicals focus on in the coming days?
Well, as I suggested in my previous answer, I think that there are priorities that are attributed to us that we're not completely under control of. I mean, a pastor may, you know, want people to think that their church is, you know, focused on the gospel and the Bible and so forth, and then outside observers may just assume that all you care about is politics. So, but I think that at least that evangelical churches, if they really want to be in sync with the historic theological tradition of evangelicalism, they need to be focused on what has always made evangelicals evangelicals, which is the Bible and conversion and the felt presence of God and you know, helping people to know what it means to walk with God in faith. I think that means that we need to be probably extra careful about not watering all that down with ephemeral political concerns. Not that we check out from politics. I don't think that would be an overreaction to just withdraw. But I think we need to keep our priorities straight. I think that we should, as best we can, be the sort of churches and evangelical people who, when outside observers look at us, say on social media or something like that, their first thought is, oh yeah, that's that guy who's always talking about Jesus. That's that guy who had a born again experience. That's that guy who wants other people to believe in Jesus too for salvation, as opposed to, oh yeah, that's that guy who rants about politics. I think that that's something that individuals need to be concerned about, and churches need to be concerned about the message that they're conveying too, and also forming people into Christ followers who are really laser focused on the gospel. And so, it may not be, my church's fault or, any individual's fault that I'm around that people have this impression. And there are definitely a fairly small group of what I call Republican insider evangelicals who will always want to turn the discussion back to partisan politics. And unfortunately, those are the people, in my view, who the media is going to continue gravitating towards. Because the secular media in particular, I mean, I don't blame them for covering what sells, and what sells is political conflict and scandal. They'll also cover evangelicals about evangelical scandals. And I don't really blame them at all, because they're just serving a market. They are not inclined to cover evangelicals for their prayer services or for sending missionaries around the world and so forth. That's just not the sort of stuff that makes it into the mainstream news. But certainly we as evangelicals don't want to be feeding the narrative that we're fundamentally concerned about politics and not about faith in God and knowing the Lord and studying the Bible and those sorts of things that I really think are what at the end of the day make an evangelical an evangelical.
Yeah, that's really well said. I think we would do well as evangelicals to study the Bible that we say we believe in, and maybe take a hard look at the passages that talk about the way that we use our language.
Yes.
That would correct most of the problems that we have, I think. So.
Yeah.
Well, Dr. Kidd, what role should the Bible have in evangelicalism today?
Well, an evangelicalism that deserves the name has to be deeply, deeply based on the Bible. And of course, you know, what that means in practice in terms of the conclusions that we reach from the Bible about various social and political issues is always going to be controversial. But it's not hard to demonstrate that evangelical, self-identifying evangelicals, I always have to give that caveat because sometimes I think we're held responsible for people who say that they're evangelicals who are pretty recognizably not evangelicals, either because they're not involved with church or they hold beliefs that, you know, and say universal salvation or something like that, but those are not evangelical beliefs historically. So I think that it's both a cliche coming out of evangelical culture, but I think it really is one of the essential aspects of what could help the current crisis that evangelicals are in is to be just deeply, deeply, deeply rooted in the Bible, the biblical tradition, historical theology. If we do that, one of the things that it will introduce us to is the ways in which the way we act and what we project and what we emphasize is historically peculiar. Because, you know, evangelicals have routinely been involved in politics, but there's never been a time when evangelicalism has been so closely associated with politics, in particular one political party. It's just historically unprecedented. And Christians should always have their radar out for things that we say, we confess, we believe, we emphasize that are historically unprecedented. That usually means they're wrong. So, you know, if it's newfangled, it's probably wrong in the Christian tradition. If we're really rooted in Scripture and the you know, attentive to the great cloud of witnesses and so forth, I think that can really help us to correct our present day excesses that we get into, not just about politics, but about social issues and you know, cultural things where we've been co-opted by the culture. The Bible and the historic Christian tradition can help alert us to those things.
Yeah, that's really, really a good word. We have, you know, people that believe in all the things that you just said, but then they don't take it into their everyday experience. And that's where we talk about, theologians talk about the sufficiency of Scripture. You know, it's like, you know, house has a foundation. Everybody knows that. And those are the basics of our faith. You know, what we believe, what you just said, you know, about the inspiration, inerrancy, and authority and clarity of Scripture would be the foundation. And then, you know, in a house, you have windows and you look out the windows. That's how do you... You take that into your everyday, you see the world around you, and that's where you take the foundational beliefs and you apply it to the stuff of life. And you have people that aren't doing that. So we have to ask, do we believe those, do we believe the right, do we have the right foundation? I don't have an answer for that. The statistics, I would seem to think, don't say no, but you know, that there's not, everybody isn't, included in those statistics, as you know, Dr. Kidd, so we can't make that right. We can't make a sweeping generalization there, but I think it's alarming for sure. So.
Yeah.
How do we resolve the gap between much of what evangelicalism entails in everyday practice and how evangelicals appear in the media coverage today?
Well, I think that it's time for pastors and church leaders just to be really careful about making it clear that our churches are not primarily or really even secondarily political advocacy groups. There's going to be topics that come up in your preaching diet, just as a matter of course, about the nature of marriage, the value of life, and these kind of issues that have immediate political implications today, and we shouldn't steer away from that. But we need to remember that you know, these political commitments are ephemeral and they come and go, and they are not doing the work of the kingdom for us. The government is never going to do the work of the kingdom for us. And so that we need to keep all the priorities very clear and in order. And if anything, in this day and age, I think that pastors need to bend over backwards to communicate to people that we are not, as a church, trying to take sides politically, certainly not with any particular party or candidate, and that we don't place expectations on people about their or partisan activity. This was just part of the excess, in my view, of the moral majority and groups like it, that, they would even say, the leaders would say, our priority as evangelical leaders is to get people saved, baptized, and registered to vote. Well, evangelicals should applaud the first two and say, the third is something that other people can worry about. It's just not it too easily, and it has become confusing to outsiders and appropriated by the media, appropriated by certain politicians to make it very confusing to understand what the gospel message is and what the priority of the church is. I don't think complete disengagement is the answer, but we're a long way at this point from complete disengagement. I mean, we're much closer to the other extreme, which is hyper-politicization, and just giving the watching world the impression that we're basically just a political party at prayer. It's no good. Evangelicals are not the only ones who have ever been to blame for this kind of behavior, but this sort of overt politicization has just got to stop. And we're not, as I said, we're not in complete control of the media narrative about it, but we certainly don't want to give them any extra ammunition in terms of injecting partisan politics into the everyday life of churches.
Yeah, that's really good. Just kind of maybe briefly touching on this, you kind of touched on this. How should our biblical and theological convictions inform our political engagement and choices in the polls?
Well, I think that, as I suggested before, our biblical worldview is necessarily going to have political implications. And on some of those issues, I happen to think that there's some questions that are pretty clear. I think probably number one on the list for me is the right to life and the immorality of abortion and euthanasia and eugenics and those sorts of things. And we shouldn't shy away from the fact that there are certain beliefs that we have that are going to have political implications. But I think in most cases that pastors need to be humble, not overly eager to draw one-to-one political conclusions from what the Bible says to some current events kind of issue about, say, the immigration issues or tax issues, climate change. I mean, most of those issues that we deal with are very complex and are not going to be directly addressed in a sort of contemporary way by what Scripture tells us. So I get very this is a bipartisan thing. I get very uncomfortable when Christian leaders on the left or right start making these simplistic conclusions about, well, here's this proof text, and therefore we should do what the Republicans say about immigration, or we should do what the Democrats say about immigration. There's principles there, for sure. I mean, there's principles there that can inform our thinking. But I think that in most cases, the church should definitely stop short of endorsing a contemporary political view. And we should not be carrying water for, a particular political party. And so I in the book, I talk about that. I think in some ways that you look at white majority churches tend to be too much, beholden to the Republican Party in America, but black majority churches tend to be too beholden to the Democratic Party. The percentages are, in the 80s or 90s percent for both groups. I tend to kind of like the Hispanic evangelical model, where their leaders, alignments are the most up for grabs in terms of their partisan alignments, because they're the sort of people who say, people like Samuel Rodriguez, a very prominent Hispanic evangelical leader, says, look, I believe in sanctity of marriage, one man, one woman. I believe in the sanctity of human life. But I also believe in helping the poor and, working for social justice and these kind of things. So, my political beliefs as a Christian just don't 100% sync up with any political options that are out there today. So in the next election, I'll just have to see how it goes. I think that's a pretty healthy, at least dose of taking a step back from any particular political party and letting our biblical worldview inform our politics, but not getting to where we just use the Bible as a sort of prop to endorse whatever our favorite party happens to endorse.
Yeah, I think that's a helpful consideration for our listeners that they should definitely think a lot about, I believe. Well, there's a lot that we haven't talked about, Dr. Kidd, and just as we wrap up, could you give us a few takeaways?
Well, I would like to think that evangelicals would be able to make a distinction between this kind of politicized image of evangelicals, which is the standard bearer in the media, and what the historic evangelical tradition is about. I mean, if you're a self-identifying evangelical and you know all about Donald Trump, but you don't know about George Whitefield and Jonathan Edwards, I would want you to have a little more depth to how you frame your evangelical commitments and identity. And that to me is just a matter of identifying with our cloud of witnesses, our spiritual autobiography, where we came from. And like I said before, I think that if we're attentive, first and foremost, to the whole Bible and going deep with the Bible, and also understanding how great believers in the past have interacted with the Bible, that will give us a sort of spiritual compass that will alert us to when we've gotten off on ephemeral, very time-bound things, but the issues that most Christians in the past have either not known about, couldn't be part of. I think this intense Americanism that we associate with the evangelical movement, and one of the reasons it's so peculiar and strange is because most of the global evangelical movement today can't share in it. American patriotism, it just doesn't mean anything to, a believer in Nigeria or a believer in China. And if you really heavily emphasize things that people in the past as evangelicals or people today in the present and around the world can't share in as believers, I think you've gotten off track. That's what I would want individual Christians and churches to think about, that we really need to be guided first and foremost by Scripture, but by, if you identify as an evangelical, by the historic evangelical tradition, and more deeply the Reformed tradition, the tradition of the Reformers. And if what you emphasize as a believer doesn't sync up with that, I think it should be a warning sign to you that maybe you've gotten sucked in by the ephemeral and the political and the temporary. And I think at least that those kind of concerns are always being attributed now to evangelicals. And like I said before, we shouldn't give them more ammunition to do that.
Yeah, that's a really good answer. Thank you. Well, where can people go to learn more about your work on social media or just your writing in general, Dr. Kidd?
No, I'm on Facebook and Twitter and Instagram. My handle is at Thomas S. Kidd. So you can see all about my work and what I'm up to, and Who is an Evangelical is certainly available at Amazon, Barnes & Noble, and the usual book outlets online. I'm very active, especially on Twitter and Instagram these days. And so I'd love it if your listeners would catch up with me there.
Yeah, we'll definitely link to all that so people can find you. And I encourage you to follow Dr. Kidd and to check out this book. It's really well written and thoughtful. So Dr. Kidd, as always, I really appreciate your time and the hard work that you put into everything that you write. And if our listeners don't know, I'll also link to this. Dr. Kidd has an outstanding newsletter that he sends out about once a week. Is that right?
Yeah, usually once every week or two. And if you're interested in signing up for that, you can find the sign up on my Twitter profile.
Yeah. Well, Dr. Kidd, I hope that you have a blessed rest of your day. And thank you again for your time.
Thanks, Dave.
Thank you so much for listening. We hope that you were encouraged by today's episode. Don't forget to subscribe and leave us a review wherever you get your podcast. For more uplifting and thought-provoking content, please visit us online at servantsofgrace.org. You can also follow us on Twitter and Instagram at Servants of Grace, and on Facebook at facebook.com/servantsofgrace. We hope you have a blessed day, and we will see you next time.